The Brave Little Tailor. One fine summer's day, a little tailor sat at his table by the window, and in the best of spirits, he sewed for dear life. As he sat there, a peasant woman came down the street, calling out, "Good jam to sell! Good jam to sell!" This sounded sweet in the tailor's ears. So he put his frail little head out of the window and shouted, "Up here, my good woman, and you'll find a willing customer." The woman climbed up the 3 flights of stairs with her heavy basket to the tailor's room, and he asked her to spread out all the jars in a row before him, examining them all, lifting them up and smelling them, and said at last, "This jam seems good. Give me 4 jars of it, my good woman." The woman, who had hoped to sell much more, gave him what he wanted, but went away grumbling ungratefully. "Now heaven shall bless this jam for my use," cried the little tailor, "and it shall sustain and strengthen me." He got some bread out of a cupboard, cut a piece off the loaf, and spread the jam on it. "That will taste good," he said, "but I'll finish sewing that coat first before I take a bite." He placed the bread beside him, went on sewing, and out of the lightness of his heart, kept on making his stitches bigger and bigger. In the meantime, the smell of the sweet jam rose to the ceiling, where swarms of flies were sitting, and attracted them to such an extent that they swarmed onto it in masses. "Ha! Who invited you?" asked the tailor, and chased the unwelcome guests away. But the flies, who didn't understand English, refused to be scared off, and returned again in even greater numbers. At last, the little tailor, losing all patience, grabbed a fly swatter and beat them mercilessly. When he was done, he counted no fewer than 7 dead flies before him with outstretched legs. "What a brave fellow I am," said he, and was filled with admiration at his own courage. "The whole town must know about this." And in great haste, the little tailor cut out a piece of cloth, hemmed it, and embroidered on it in big letters, 7 at a blow. "What did I say, the town? No, the whole world shall hear of it," he said, and his heart beat for joy as a lamb wags his tail. The tailor strapped the cloth around his waist and set out into the wide world. Before he left, however, he looked around about him to see if there was anything in the house he could take on his journey. But he found nothing except for an old brick of cheese, which he took. In front of the house, he noticed a bird that had been caught in the bushes, and he put that into the bag too. Then he went on his way merrily. His way led up a hill, on the top of which sat a powerful giant, who was calmly surveying the landscape. The little tailor went up to him, and greeting him cheerfully said, "Good day, my massive friend. There you sit at your ease, viewing the whole wide world. I'm just on my way there. What do you say to coming along with me?" The giant looked contemptuously at the tailor and said,
"What a poor little wretched creature you are."
The little tailor unbuttoned his coat and showed the giant the belt that he had embroidered.
"There now, you can read for yourself what sort of fellow I am."
The giant read, 7 at a blow, and thinking they were human beings the tailor had slain, he gained a certain respect for the little man. But giants are skeptical creatures, so he thought he'd test him. Taking a stone in his hand, he squeezed it till drops of water ran out.
"Now, You do the same,
said the giant.
Is that all? Asked the little tailor. That's child's play to me.
So he brought out the cheese from his bag and pressed it until the whey ran out.
My squeeze was better than yours, he said.
The giant didn't know what to say, for he couldn't have believed it of the little fellow. To prove him again, the giant lifted a stone and threw it so high that the eye could hardly follow it.
Now, little pygmy, I bet you can't do that.
Well thrown, said the tailor. But, after all, your stone fell to the ground. I'll throw one that won't come down at all.
He dived into his bag again, and grasping the bird in his hand, he threw it up in the air.
The bird was glad to be free, and it soared up into the sky and flew away, never to return.
Well, what do you think of that little piece of business, giant?
You certainly can throw,
said the giant.
But now, let's see how much you can carry.
With these words, he led the tailor to a huge oak tree, which had been felled to the ground, and said,
If you think you're so strong, help me carry this tree out of the forest.
Most certainly, said the little tailor. You take the trunk on your shoulder, and I'll bear the top and branches, which is by far the heaviest part.
The giant laid the trunk on his shoulder, but the tailor sat at his ease among the branches. And the giant, who couldn't see what was going on behind him, had to carry the whole tree, and the little tailor as well. There he sat on a branch, happily whistling a tune, as if carrying the tree were mere sport. The giant, after dragging the heavy weight for some time, could go no further, and shouted out,
I can go no further. I must let the tree down.
Fancy a big lout like you not being able to carry a tree.
Well, you're a fine little fellow after all,
said the giant.
Why don't you come and spend the night with me and my friends in our cave?
The little tailor willingly consented to do this. And following his friend, they went on until they reached a cave, where several other giants were sitting around a fire, each holding a roast sheep in his hand, of which he was eating. The little tailor looked about him and marveled at the size of the cave. The giant showed him a bed and invited him to lie down and have a good sleep. But the bed was too big for the little tailor, so he didn't get into it, but crept away into the corner. At midnight, when the giant thought the little tailor was fast asleep, he rose up and, taking his big iron walking stick, broke the bed in two with a blow and thought he had made an end of the little tailor. At early dawn, the giants went off to the forest and forgot all about the little tailor until all of a sudden they met him walking cheerfully along. The giants were terrified, thinking it was a ghost. And afraid that he would slay them, they all ran away as fast as they could. The little tailor continued to follow his nose, and after he had wandered about for a long time, he came upon the courtyard of a royal palace. And feeling tired, he lay down on the grass and fell asleep. While he lay there, many people came, and looking him over, they read on his belt, 7 at a blow.
Oh, they said, what can this great hero of 100 fights want in our peaceful land? He must indeed be a mighty man of valor.
They went and told the king about him, and said what a useful man he'd be in time of war, and that it would be well to secure his services at any price. This idea pleased the king, So he was received with all honor and given a special house of his own to live in. But the other officers resented the success of the little tailor and wished him gone. "What's to come of it all?" they asked each other. "If we quarrel with him, he'll attack us. And at every blow, 7 will die, and that'll soon be the end of us." So they resolved to go as a group to the king and resign their posts. They said that they would not be able to hold out against a man who kills 7 at a blow. The king was grieved at the thought of losing all his faithful servants for the sake of one man, and he wished that he had never set eyes on him, or that he could get rid of him. But he didn't dare to send him away, for he feared he might kill him along with his people and place himself on the throne. The king pondered long and deeply over the matter and finally came to a conclusion. He sent for the tailor and told him that, seeing what a great and warlike hero he was about to make him an offer. In a certain forest of his kingdom, there dwelled 2 giants who robbed and murdered and burned and plundered everything about them. But if the tailor could overcome and kill these 2 giants, the king would give him his only daughter for a wife, and half his kingdom as well. For extra measure, he would have 100 horsemen to back him up.
"That's the very thing for a man like me,"
shouted the little tailor. "One doesn't get the offer of a beautiful princess and half the kingdom every day." So he answered,
"I'll do it, and soon put an end to the giants. But I have no need of your 100 horsemen. A fellow who can slay 7 men at a blow need not be afraid of 2.
The little tailor set out, and the 100 horsemen followed him. When he came to the outskirts of the forest, he said to his followers,
"You wait here. I'll manage the giants by myself."
So he went on into the woods, looking right and left. After a while, he spied the 2 giants lying asleep under a tree and snoring till the very boughs bent with the breeze. The little tailor lost no time in filling his bag with stones, and then climbed up the tree under which they lay. When he got about to the middle of it, he slipped along a branch till he sat just above the sleepers. Then he threw down 1 stone after the other on the nearest giant. The giant felt nothing for a long time, but at last he woke up and, pinching his companion, said,
"Hey, what did you do that for?"
"I didn't hit you. You must be dreaming,"
said the other. They both lay down to sleep again. And the tailor threw another stone on the 2nd giant, who sprang up and cried,
"Hey, what's that for? Why did you throw something at me?"
"I did not throw anything,"
growled the 1st one. They argued on for a while until they settled the matter and fell asleep again. The little tailor began his game once more and flung the largest stone he could find in his bag with all his might and hit the 1st giant on the chest.
"All right, that is the last time you shall do that,"
he yelled, and springing up like a madman, he knocked his companion against the tree until the tree trunk shook. He gave, however, as good as he got, and they became so enraged that they tore up trees and beat each other with them till they both fell dead on the ground. Then the little tailor jumped down, drew his sword, and gave each of the giants a very fine thrust or 2, and then went to the horsemen and said,
"The deed is done. I put an end to the 2 of them. but I assure you it was no easy matter. For even they tore up trees in their struggle to defend themselves. But all that's of no use against one who slays 7 men at a blow.
The little tailor now demanded the promised reward from the king. But the king refused to keep his promise and pondered once more how he could rid himself of the hero.
"Before you obtain the hand of my daughter and half my kingdom," he said to him, "you must do another deed of valor."
The tailor was to catch a wild boar for him that was running wild in the forest. And again he had the 100 horsemen to help him. But he didn't take the horsemen into the wood with him. And they were well enough pleased to remain behind, for they were all afraid of the wild boar. As soon as the great pig saw the tailor, it ran at him with foaming mouth and gleaming teeth, and tried to knock him down. But the tailor ran into a chapel that was nearby, and then jumped right out the window. The wild boar chased him into the church, but the tailor ran around the door and closed it. So the raging beast was caught. Then the hero went before the king, who was obliged now, whether he liked it or not, to keep his promise, and hand over his daughter and half his kingdom. Had he known that it was no hero warrior, but only a little tailor who stood before him, it would have even been harder for him to swallow. So the wedding was celebrated with much splendor and little joy, and the tailor became a king. Now after a time, the queen heard her husband saying one night in his sleep,
"My lad, make the waistcoat and patch these trousers, or I'll box your ears."
And so she learned the true identity of her husband. And the next day, she cried to her father, the king, and begged him to help her to get rid of her husband, who was nothing more than a tailor. The king comforted her and said,
"Leave your bedroom door open tonight. My servants shall stand outside, and when your husband is fast asleep, they shall enter, bind him fast, and carry him onto a ship, which will take him far, far away. And you will never have to see him again."
The queen was well satisfied with the idea, but the tailor's servant had overheard everything and went straight to him and revealed the whole plot.
"I'll soon put a stop to that," said the tailor.
That night, he and his wife went to bed at the usual time. And when she thought he had fallen asleep, she got up, opened the door, and then lay down again. The little tailor, who had only pretended to be asleep, began to call out in a clear voice,
"My lad, make that waistcoat and patch those trousers, or I'll box your ears. I've killed 7 men at a blow, slain 2 giants, and caught a wild boar. So why should I be afraid of those men standing outside my door?"
The men, when they heard the tailor saying these words, were so terrified that they fled as if pursued by a wild army, and dared never to go near him again. And so the brave little tailor remained a king all the days of his life.